Hi DIYers, Sterling with Alarm Grid here. Today we're going to show you how to program a 2GIG CO3-345 wireless carbon monoxide detector. The CO3 is a great detector to add to your 2GIG Go control panel as it will provide added value as you're no longer protecting just against burglary, but now you're protecting also against the odorless and invisible deadly gas of carbon monoxide. More and more jurisdictions in the country, in fact, are requiring carbon monoxides in homes and commercial spaces. And while there are standalone carbon monoxide detectors, if you already have a security system that can incorporate a carbon monoxide, it's a really nice option. So we're going to show you how to program this CO3 to your 2GIG Go control. Just like with any zone programming, the first thing we want to do is hit security, followed by menu and toolbox. Now we are prompted for a code. This is not your master code that you use to arm or disarm. This is our programmer code. As long as it hasn't been changed, the code will be 1561. Now we're in our toolbox, and if we hit the right arrow twice, we see the option for installer toolbox. That is the menu that allows you to get into your system configuration and program your zones. Once you're in system configuration on the 2GIG panel, there is a question-based option for programming all of your parameters. Whether it's zones or system features and options, you select the question you want to go to program. In our case, the wireless zones are programmed under Q1 or question 1. You can see at the top that it says select RF sensor number, and we have number 01 to 48 because our 2GIG Go control supports up to 48 wireless zones. Each detector is typically one zone in the system. Our system has not been programmed with any sensors yet, so we're going to go ahead and choose zone number 1. So at the top we have Q1, again wireless zones, and then down here we have the zone that we're going to program. If we already had zones programmed, we could hit the right arrow to go to the next available zone. In our case, 01 is fine. We hit the down arrow, and we are asked for the RF sensor 1 type. So now we're on a queue without a number. This is a subset question within queue number 1, and we're on zone number 1. It shows at the top RF sensor 1, and they're asking for the type. We have a list of sensor types on our website with descriptions for which one they are. If you hit the right arrow, you can see as they scroll through entry exit 1, entry exit 2 and perimeter for doors and windows. We have interior follower for motions, and if we continue on down, we want to do 24-hour auxiliary alarm. We want to do 24-hour carbon monoxide for this one, which is a specific zone type for our carbon monoxide detector. The 24-hour carbon monoxide zone type will activate whether the system is armed or disarmed. Very critical. If there's carbon monoxide in the house, of course we want to know about it no matter what. The system doesn't need to be armed for this device to work. We hit the down arrow to lock that in, and now we are asked for this sensor equipment code. This is not really going to affect the way that the sensor talks to the system, but if you are monitored, this information goes out to alarm.com, and then your alarm company will know exactly what type of device you're using. While a Honeywell wireless carbon monoxide would work with this system, we want to tell the panel and our monitoring company that we are using the 2GIG CO detector. So right there, we highlight that option and hit the down arrow, and now we're ready to program our serial number. On this device, just like all other 2GIG devices, or nearly all, we have our TXID number displayed as a 7-digit number, 3 digits-4 digits. We can type it in, or my personal preference and what we recommend is that you hit shift and then learn, and now we're waiting for sensor number transmission. So this is a way to auto-enroll the device. The advantage of an auto-enrollment is that not only do you avoid user errors when typing in the number, but you're simultaneously programming the serial number and verifying that the sensor has a good battery and that it's functional. So basically, we close this device up. And then once it's closed, we're going to tamper it to auto-enroll the sensor. So with it closed, this hole lines up with the tab here. And if we were to then counterclockwise and open, we have our 0710932 transmission ID number enrolled on the screen, confirming that we do have a good sensor and that it is programmed. If we hit OK, we can hit the down arrow. And now they're asking about the equipment age. If this is a brand new sensor, leave it on new. If this is an existing sensor, because of prior installation, you could highlight existing. In our case, brand new device, we're going to lock it in on new. Sensor 1 loop number, just like with nearly every 2GIG device, we want to do loop number 1. So we're going to leave it on that and hit the down arrow. And now we want to name our device or construct our RF sensor 1 voice descriptor. We have a chart that's on the back side of our 2GIG Go Control quick programming guide, which is described as our voice descriptors. And instead of keying in with an alpha keypad, we are literally choosing words from a preset library. Each word has a 3-digit number that's associated with that word. So if we want to call this our living room carbon monoxide detector, we hit insert first, which puts our first word as abort. That's just the very first word in the library, why it defaults to abort. You could hit the right arrow to cycle through every word, but on this list there's 286 words and this list does get updated, so that would be a lot of scrolling. Instead, if we were to hit insert and just type in for living, it would be 133. Room is 187, so we hit insert to lock in living, 187 to change to room, insert again to lock it in, and now we want carbon monoxide, which happens to be one 3-digit value, which will give us both words carbon monoxide. We still have room for two more words because each zone has 5 available voice descriptors to put in, but in our case we have a nice descriptive voice descriptor for our zone, and we hit the down arrow to lock it in and advance to sensor 1 reports. If you wanted this to be just a local alarm, to sound the local alarm at the CO device, sound the alarm at our 2GIG Go Control panel and not go to the central station, you could do that by disabling the reporting. If your system is monitored, we would never encourage you to do that. You would always want it enabled, but if you did run this just as a local system without any kind of monitoring, you could do that. In our case, our system will be monitored, so we're going to choose enabled by hitting the down arrow. Now we're on a question about supervision. It says sensor 1 supervised, 0 for no and 1 for enabled, or rather 0 for disabled and 1 for enabled. Supervision will tell the system about low battery issues and range issues on your CO3 device. So instead of wondering is this good, the system will periodically check and say, are you there and is your battery good? If it sees a low battery, it's going to tell you a zone 1 low battery message. Now you know you have to go and immediately change out your battery so that you will accurately detect carbon monoxide gas in your home. The supervision will also tell you whether or not this device is in range. So again, the panel's periodically checking out and saying, are you there? As long as this CO3 says, yep, I'm here, it goes on to the next zone and says, are you there? If this CO3 never checks in because something environmentally changed and now it's too far from the panel, or it was damaged somehow and it just doesn't check in, the panel will alert you, hey, something happened to this zone or this sensor. Now you know to go take a look. Was it damaged? Was it removed? Was something introduced in the environment between the panel and the sensor? All of those things could cause a supervision problem, and with it supervised, you'll know about that in advance. Very important that you supervise your devices. If you hit the down arrow, it's going to ask you about chime. That is not something you would set up on a 24-hour device, because activation of this device or a fault of this device will be an alarm whether you're armed or disarmed. So we leave it as disabled and hit the down arrow. And now we're on a summary screen for our CO3 wireless detector. We can see that we properly learned it as a 24-hour carbon monoxide device. We've properly told it that it's a 2GIG CO detector. We have the proper serial number. We have that it is a brand new device on loop number one called living room carbon monoxide, where we will install our CO detector. Finally, we have reports enabled. Yes, we want to send these alarm events to our central station. Supervised, yes, we want to know about low battery and range issues. And finally, chime disabled. So we are good. We didn't make any mistakes in our programming. If we hit skip, it advances to question number two. If you had more zones to program, you could hit go to, put in 01, go back to question number one, advance to zone two, and continue on with your sensor programming. If this is the only sensor you're programming, you hit end. You see a summary screen for all of your system programming options. So maybe you had changed your dial delays or programmed in a central station phone number, and then you did your program for your CO. So you have a chance to review those other changes you made. In our case, all we've done is program our CO3. So we hit exit. If you've never worked with a 2GIG Go control, do not be alarmed that the paneled screen goes dark. Anytime you make a programming change and save it and exit, the system reboots by design. You have to wait a few seconds and then you'll hear the system say disarm, ready to arm. And then
system disarmed, ready to arm.
And then you'll see a few seconds later our touchscreen keypad wakes back up and we can use our CO3 test button to ensure that we properly programmed our device.
Carbon monoxide, living room, carbon monoxide.
That is the noise that you hear when you have a zone type set to 24-hour carbon monoxide. You notice when I first pressed and held the test that we only heard the local audible noise from the detector. Press and hold a bit longer and you get the alarm to actually go to the panel. We have our default master code of 1111, alarm report already transmission, cancel being sent. That just means that we've disarmed within the cancel window, so we're canceling all our alarm from going to the central station. Since it was a test, that's what we want. We hit OK. We can see that we have this alarm on the screen and we can clear it because, of course, we did that by design. We're back to disarmed, ready to arm. We have properly programmed our 2GIG CO3-345 wireless carbon monoxide detector to our 2GIG Go control panel. We hope that you've enjoyed this video. We invite you to subscribe to our channel. And if you have any questions on your CO3 or how to program it to your 2GIG Go control, please email support@alarmgrid.com.